Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. Every week on Exploration, we discuss the fascinating world of science and its impact on society. And today, leading off, we're going to summarize some of the top stories in science, and then I'll be answering some of the emails that I get. There's no way that I can answer all the emails that come pouring in, so I'll answer them collectively today on Exploration. Leading off, we're going to summarize some of the top stories, including the statement that some skeptics believe that carbon dioxide is good for us. It's good for plants, it's good for animals, so what's this hullabaloo about global warming? Well, there's a new study coming out, published in Science magazine, that shows that global warming once wiped out 90% or so of life forms on the planet Earth. And also, God is in the news, believe it or not. Einstein's God letter, after much anticipation, finally went up for auction, and it sold for $2.87 million, breaking records. Who would have thought that a letter that Einstein dashed off about God and religion would fetch $2.8 million. So we'll say a few things about the meaning of the God letter. In fact, unfortunately, I think the media got it all wrong as to the real thrust of that letter. Einstein did not mean to say that, well, God is nothing but a fairy tale. No, it's deeper than that. And then we'll say a few things about gene therapy, which is in the news. The Chinese have more or less reprimanded a scientist in China who did this unauthorized experiment on humans, and children were born with genetically modified genes. This is the first time it's been done, and it's caused a tremendous amount of controversy. So we'll say a few things about germline gene therapy and somatic gene therapy. And then we'll answer a few emails that I get. One persistent email concerns flying saucers and UFOs. The United States government recently released, of course, a batch of old files showing that, well, yes, there are strange things happening in the skies. Our pilots have been buzzed by some kind of object that zigzags, travels faster than any known object. And, hey, it's not supposed to be that way. There's no, none of our weapons can do this. And so some people say, aha, there's a cover-up. It's aliens after all. So we'll see a few things about that. Well, our lead story today concerns global warming and, well, what set off some of the mass extinctions of the past. The skeptics of global warming say that carbon dioxide is actually good for us. I mean, after all, plants take in carbon dioxide and release oxygen. So plants thrive in a greenhouse where we have lots of carbon dioxide. So what's wrong with having a lush, tropical-like environment? Well, plenty. Here's a new report coming out of Science magazine. Scientists have done a computer simulation of what might have caused a mass extinction 252 million years ago. It was one of the greatest mass extinctions in the history of planet Earth. Now, we all know that the dinosaurs got wiped out about 65 million years ago when a comet or meteor slammed into Mexico. But what created the dinosaurs? So if the dinosaurs were destroyed by a comet or meteor, what catastrophic event set into motion the dinosaur evolution? Well, it was this mass extinction 252 million years ago between the Permian and the Triassic era. Something happened which wiped out previous life forms, including the trilobites, ushering in the age of dinosaurs. So in other words, dinosaurs were bookended by something that set into motion the dinosaur revolution 252 million years ago, and then something bookended them and wiped them out 65 million years ago. Well, here's a new theory. It turns out that 252 million years ago, geologists know that there were gigantic volcanic eruptions on the planet Earth, releasing copious amounts of carbon dioxide, because that's what comes out of volcanic eruptions. Sulfur, carbon dioxide, noxious gases. And with all this carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, well, sea rise took place, 20-degree rise in the temperature of the oceans, which wiped out many sea life forms. But more important, the oceans began to lose their oxygen content. And so large aquatic animals could no longer survive. And of course, the food chain depends upon life in the oceans. And so with the loss of oxygen content in the oceans, with the rise in temperature by 20 degrees, computer simulations show that, well, on the order of 96% of all sea life died as a consequence, and 70% of land animals also died. That is, of course, catastrophic. That is one of the greatest mass extinctions in the history of the planet Earth, and we think it was caused by global warming. And that is, with tremendous amounts of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, sea rise took place, temperatures rose 20 degrees, and in addition, the oxygen content of the oceans plummeted, killing off many sea life that depends upon oxygen, and of course, land animals that depend upon sea life. The report concludes by saying that we could be headed for something not as catastrophic as that, but similar. That by mid-century, we're talking about a gigantic disruption in the ecology of the planet Earth because of global warming, not on the scale of what happened, of course, 252 million years ago. But the United Nations last month issued this rather gloomy report. It was co-authored by 90 scientists with 6,000 scientists peer-reviewing the report, talking about what's going to happen between 2030 and 2052. At the rate we're going, we're talking about another 1.5-degree rise in temperature, which means that ocean levels will rise. We're going to have more 100-year storms, 100-year droughts, 100-year forest fires, because we're now tampering with the Earth itself. Now, does that mean that you can point to one forest fire, one hurricane or whatever, and say, aha, that's the fingerprint of global warming? And the answer is no. Global warming is an average effect. You cannot say with certainty that any one particular storm or drought or freeze or forest fire was caused by global warming. But if you look at the average, you find that all the averages are rising in the up direction, not the down direction. We're talking about rising sea levels, increased temperatures, rapid fluctuations of the atmosphere on the planet Earth. And in some sense, global warming is a misnomer because it's really global swings that are the byproduct of all this chaos. So a word to the wise. The people who wrote this report for Science Magazine noted that it was carbon dioxide which created the greatest mass extinction on the planet Earth, and we're going to be duplicating on a much smaller scale many of what happened, many of the things that happened 252 million years ago. So if you want a preview of the worst case scenario, simply read the biology history books about mass extinctions in our own history. And some people think, by the way, that we're now experiencing a new mass extinction. Another comet, another meteor has hit the Earth, and that meteor or comet is called Homo sapiens. And also, believe it or not, God is in the news. That's right. The so-called Einstein God letter went up for auction last week, and it sold for, get this, a whopping $2.87 million. Who would have thought? Who would have thought that a letter that Einstein dashed off, which mentions God and religion, would sell for $2.87 million? Well, unfortunately, the media, I think, got it partially wrong. The letter does say that Einstein believed that God is basically sort of like a fairy tale with childish stories that we hand down from generation to generation. But I think the media got it wrong. And that is that Einstein himself said that he's not an atheist, and that you have to distinguish between two types of God, which are not clarified in the media analysis of the God letter. Einstein believed that there were two kinds of God. The first is the personal God, the God that answers your prayers, the God that smites the Philistines, wipes out your enemies, that grants you that bicycle at Christmas time that you prayed for. Einstein did not believe in a personal God. He didn't think that the God that created the universe would spend that much time making sure that you got that red bicycle for Christmas. He instead believed in the God of Spinoza. That is the God of beauty, harmony, simplicity, and order. That the universe was not, in some sense, just a random accident, which would have produced something that was ugly and random, chaotic. The universe, however, is quite regular. It is rather simple and is elegant. And so Einstein believed that he was like a young child entering into a gigantic library for the first time, all these books containing the secrets of the universe, and all he could do was take volume one and open the first page and read the first paragraph. So that's how he viewed God, the God of Spinoza, not necessarily being just a collection of fairy tales, which is how the media interpreted. Now, this has implications because my colleague Stephen Hawking, who passed away recently, has a new book published posthumously. And in that book, he says that, well, there is no God, no God at all. Forget the God of Spinoza, the God, the personal God that you pray to. No, none of those gods exist. And how does he know? He knows by invoking Einstein, by saying that there was a Big Bang and there was simply no time, no time in which to create a universe. In other words, time began at the instant of the Big Bang itself. The universe fully formed at that point, and there was simply no time for God to create the universe. Well, that sounds like an interesting theory, but first of all, that's not the way Einstein viewed it at all. Einstein realized that, yes, at the instant of the Big Bang, the universe was a fireball that created the universe that we see around us. It all happened in a fraction of a second, but Einstein realized that that was a defect in his theory. It just showed that general relativity was incomplete. Because relativity theory says that at the instant of the Big Bang, gravitational forces were infinite. Now, there's no such thing as infinite force. That's just a byproduct of an equation which is faulty. So that's why Einstein spent the last 30 years of his life going beyond relativity to the unified field theory, where you could say that forces are finite and measurable, not infinite. And therefore, Hawking's argument, I think, relies upon an earlier thinking of Einstein. For the last 30 years of his life, Einstein realized that his theory had a defect in it, that his theory predicted infinite gravity at the center of a Big Bang, at the center of a black hole, and in reality, nothing is infinite. And therefore, the argument that there is no God because there was no time to create a universe is not the way Einstein himself looked at it. Einstein thought that his theory was incomplete, that you need a higher theory. Well, one potential higher theory is string theory, which is what I do for a living. And string theory does not say that the universe started in an instant of time, therefore there was no time for a God to create the universe. String theory says there was something before the Big Bang, that if our universe is a bubble, and if the bubble is expanding and we live on the skin of the bubble, then string theory says that there are other bubbles out there, that our bubble universe can perhaps split and create a baby universe or perhaps collide with another universe to create a bigger universe. And this multiverse is how the universe was originally created. So in other words, Big Bangs happen all the time. The Big Bang was a quantum event. We think that because inflationary theory is the leading theory of the Big Bang today. Inflationary theory fits all the data. And inflationary theory is a quantum theory. And if it happened once, therefore, there's a certain probability that it'll happen again and again and again. And so, in other words, we have to realize that Einstein himself realized that there was a defect in his theory, which required a higher theory. The leading theory for that higher theory is string theory, and string theory in turn leads us to a multiverse of universes, with universes being created all the time. Now the question is, how do we prove it? Several ways to prove it. One is the Large Hadron Collider may one day create dark matter. Dark matter, we think, is a higher excitation of the string. And if we find the Photino, the leading candidate for dark matter, that could clinch it right there. Another possibility is that dark matter will be found in our detectors. We have gigantic vats of cleaning fluid, which contain hydrogen. And if a piece of dark matter were to collide with one of these hydrogen nuclei, it may shatter it. It would create a spark, which is then measurable with our spark chambers. So in other words, it is experimentally possible to measure aspects of string theory. Also, one day, the European Union and the United States will launch LISA into orbit. LISA is the Laser Interferometry Space Antenna. It is a gigantic gravity wave detector in outer space. So sensitive, it'll pick up gravity waves from the Big Bang itself that are still circulating throughout the universe. And when it does that, we'll be able to get baby pictures of the infant universe as it emerged from the womb. And maybe, just maybe, we'll have evidence of an umbilical cord. An umbilical cord connecting the baby universe to a parent universe. And that would again reinforce the idea of a multiverse. Also in the news, by the way, it turns out a theory of Einstein has been verified by accident. That's right, by accident. It turns out that the European Union sent a satellite called the Galileo into orbit, which is their version of the GPS system. So in other words, we have the American GPS system, but the Europeans, not content, have their version of the GPS system. But it turns out that launching satellites to detect GPS waves on the planet Earth, the satellites were defective. That is, instead of moving in a near circular orbit, they moved into an elliptical orbit with a varying radius, an egg-shaped elliptical orbit. Aha! Said scientists, maybe we can take advantage of this defect, because if the orbit of a GPS satellite is elliptical, the radius of the satellite varies with time, and gravity should also vary with time. As you get closer to the Earth, gravity gets stronger, and according to general relativity, time should slow down more. When the satellite is farther away from the Earth, gravity is weaker, and time should speed up as a consequence. In other words, time beats slower on the moon than it does the Earth. In other words, time beats faster on the moon than the Earth. As a consequence, since time itself varies depending upon the strength of gravity, why not use these defective satellites to test Einstein's theory? And so they did that, and bingo, once again, Einstein's theory comes out right on the dot. Einstein's theory predicts that the GPS satellites of the European Union should, in fact, slow down and speed up, just like general relativity predicts, and lo and behold, that's what happened. Also, I'd like to answer some of the emails that I get. There's no way that I can answer all the emails, so I'll do it on radio. One persistent set of emails that I get concerns, well, once again, flying saucers. It turns out that many people saw the photographs that were taken by the United States government of something that was buzzing our aircraft. This buzzing object, well, apparently moved in a zigzag, and could outrace our jets. And they were seen not just by one person, but they were seen on radar, they were photographed, and they were seen by the pilots. What could possibly create this? Well, when you interview the pilots, they say that, well, they scratch their heads, and they say maybe it's extraterrestrial. We're talking about a technology that we don't have that's been tracked by radar. What could cause this? Well, there is several theories. The theory that I like to believe is that it's a military craft that uses hypersonic drive. So let's say a few things about that. First of all, most of our jets, as you know, are supersonic. However, there's something called hypersonic drives, where you go 5-7 times the speed of sound. And any missile which is hypersonic would be able to evade a Star Wars system. Now, how does that work? Well, when a missile comes in from outer space, just before it impacts on the Earth, causing a tremendous amount of devastation, it's tracked by radar. And then, at least according to the Air Force's scenario, anti-ballistic missiles are sent to intercept that incoming missile. Therefore, you want your incoming missile to be able to maneuver, to zigzag as it approaches its target on the planet Earth. And that's very difficult because you're going at hypersonic velocities, and it's very easy to lose control of your missile going at many times the speed of sound on re-entry into the atmosphere of the planet Earth. In fact, the United States government has admitted that two years ago, it actually did test hypersonic drive weapons. However, they were unstable, and that's the problem. As they zigzag, they can create turbulence, and the turbulence can get out of control and cause the missile to crash. Well, last March, Vladimir Putin of Russia announced the fact that they have perfected a hypersonic weapon. That was met with a certain amount of skepticism in the United States, but, well, that's the statement. Well, that's the claim. The claim is that the Russians have successfully tested a hypersonic weapon that can evade our Star Wars program. And then after that, the Chinese chimed in and said, well, yeah, we too are working on hypersonic weapons. So I cannot prove this, but I tend to think that Area 51, which has been the focus of so much interest by UFO buffs, is the place where they are testing hypersonic weapons. Now, remember the stealth bomber? The stealth bomber also created a flurry of UFO sightings, and the military actually encouraged people to think of them as flying saucers to deflect interest away from what the Air Force was really doing, which was to create the stealth bomber. Now, the stealth bomber, of course, is not really invisible, but it has the radar signature of a large bird and certainly can evade a ground radar of a radar system that's not very advanced. So the stealth bomber was a byproduct of Area 51 technology. Some people are now saying that, well, what is the military working on today? And it is hypersonic weapons. Weapons that are in the atmosphere, weapons that can maneuver, evading therefore a Star Wars system, and weapons which are stable and can be accurately guided to their targets in order to neutralize a Star Wars system. So is the hypersonic drive the reason for UFO sightings? I don't know. All I'm saying is that there is a logical possibility that what is causing people to register something buzzing our aircraft, zigzagging, traveling at fantastic velocities, well, the rumors could be generated by hypersonic weapons. Also in the news from China concerning a Chinese scientist and genetic engineering are still reverberating around the world, and people are beginning to scratch their heads and wondering, what's in it for me? What does it mean if you can now tinker with the genetic heritage of the human race? Well, first of all, let me explain the difference between germline gene therapy and somatic gene therapy. Of course, our bodies are made out of cells. The instructions given to the cell is encoded in the DNA. And if you could somehow modify it, that is called gene therapy in order to cure people of illnesses caused by misshapen or deformed genes. Now, there are two kinds of ways to do this. Somatic gene therapy is when you simply change the genes of somebody, and when they die, those altered genes die with them. And so there's very little controversy about that. Everyone agrees that somatic gene therapy is a good thing. we might be able to eliminate some of the thousands of known genetic diseases that are out there, like sickle cell anemia, like cystic fibrosis, like Tay-Sachs, like many of the other illnesses that have afflicted us ever since time immemorial. The difference now is we're talking about germline gene therapy, that is changing the genetic structure of your genes so that your children and your children's children are now modified forever. Now, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with eliminating once and for all certain defective genes? Because once these genes are eliminated, some of these genes have beneficial effects. For example, sickle cell anemia is a dreaded disease, but it turns out that it does confer a certain amount of immunity to malaria. And so when you do gene therapy, you want to make sure that it doesn't have unintended consequences. And just remember that in the future, this could get out of control. What happens when somebody announces they found a gene that makes children smarter, let's say? There's going to be a stampede. Every parent's going to want to get access to that gene. Maybe the gene is fraudulent. Maybe the gene is available only on the black market. And there could be a black market in illegal banned genes. I mean, we've been unable to regulate the drug trade. The drug trade flourishes, even though nations wail against it. What happens when genes also enter the illegal market? How are we going to stop that? Genes are nothing but information. You can code information on a sheet of paper and reconstruct the genome from that sheet of paper. How can you stop that knowledge? So we're talking about a whole new ball game, a whole new ball game when parents and people may one day be able to tinker with the genetic heritage of their progeny. And what does that mean? Society has yet to come to grips with it, but things are moving very fast because of what is called CRISPR technology. CRISPR technology is actually used by Mother Nature, used by cells and viruses. That's how they can identify sequences of genes in organisms that are harmful. So Mother Nature uses it. We've been able to use that technique in order to splice and dice genes almost at will. Well, that completes the first part of Exploration. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and we're talking about science and its impact on society. We talked about genetic engineering, and we're going to continue our dialogue about genetic engineering with Professor Greg Stock of UCLA. And the question is, how far should we go in terms of designing our progeny? What kinds of mischief can we perform if one day we can alter our genetic heritage? So once again, in the second half of Exploration, we're going to continue our discussion of genetic engineering with Professor Greg Stock. And if you want to have a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230 for a copy of today's program. Stay tuned. Welcome. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, introducing the second half of Exploration. In the first half of Exploration, we launched into outer space and took a journey to the moon and answered the question, where did the moon come from, with Dana McKenzie, author of the book, The Big Splat.
And then in the second half of exploration, we're going to talk about exploring new territory, very controversial territory, concerning how far we want to push genetic engineering. Do we want to redesign the human race? Well, with us today is Dr. Gregory Stock of UCLA, who will talk to us about the pros and cons and what the vision is for those people who want to tinker with our genetic heritage. So once again, our special guest is Dr. Gregory Stock of UCLA, and the topic is redesigning humans. And now I'd like to introduce our special guest for today. We're very delighted to have with us Professor Gregory Stock of the University of California at Los Angeles, where he's the director of the Program on Medicine, Technology, and Society. And he's the author of a very controversial book called Redesigning Humans. That's right, Redesigning Humans, Choosing Our Genes, Changing Our Future. In other words, we're not talking about something that's going to happen anytime soon, but perhaps 50 years, perhaps 100 years into the future, who knows for sure, we may have the ability to tinker with our genetic heritage. And then the question is that a good thing? Is it a good thing if every parent can begin to choose the characteristics of their children? What about the future of the human race? What about medicine? What about ethics? These and other questions we're going to be exploring with Dr. Gregory Stock of UCLA, author of the book, Redesigning Humans. Okay, the first question for you, Dr. Stock, is how did you first get interested as a youth in biology and medicine?
Well, I've sort of been interested in the issues of life for as long as I can remember, and I think the epiphany that I had being as a graduate student just about to get my doctorate in molecular biology was that suddenly I was walking on campus and realized that I didn't really know the difference between an oak tree and an elm tree. And I realized I was at too much of a molecular level, so I thought it would be worthwhile for me to step back a little bit and look at more systems biology.
Okay. And why did you specifically get interested in the whole question of genes, genetic modification, and genetic enhancement?
Well, I was developing some ideas related to sort of levels of complexity in life, and that there are multiple very distinct levels of complexity, the lowest being that of bacteria, which is just essentially a little bag of biochemicals and no internal structure or anything. And then animal cells or eukaryotes are a million times the volume. They have all sorts of compartments. They are much, much more complex. And it turns out that the origins of some of those components were, in fact, bacteria themselves, which came together symbiotically and then formed really complex organizational structures. And then this happened again with the formation of multicellular life, all of the complex multicellular organisms, the animals and plants that are filling up the environment that we see, that we can observe around us. And now there's yet another step that is occurring where, led by human activity and our fusion with telecommunication technologies and all sorts of things that are drawing us together as a very integrated sort of a superorganism, the implications of that are really profound for not just human society, which is actually an organism and can be seen very clearly as that if you look into it in detail. And that's the subject of a book I wrote called The fusion of humans and machines into a global superorganism. And I was interested in what the biggest implication of that was. And things like space travel and such are some of the products of that collaboration. But the most interesting for us, I think, is the way these technologies will then be turned back upon ourselves and reshape our own biology. And so that's how I really got interested in the sort of genomics and the various ways in which these, you know, extraordinarily precise and powerful technologies were beginning to be, to have the possibility of reshaping human life itself.
Okay, and speaking about reshaping human life, some people get a little bit squeamish when they think about that. They remember what happened with the Nazis and eugenics. However, isn't it true that historically, humans have in fact been enhancing other species, like dogs? Haven't we been breeding dogs for thousands of years? And what about plants as well?
Yes, it's definite that there is not, this is not something new. It's just that the tools that are being brought to bear upon biology are so much more sophisticated. So I think that canine breeding is an excellent example, and is actually going to serve as sort of a pilot project for our own self-modification, in that here we're using the most kind of primitive tools of selection and breeding, and look at the diversity that exists in the canine realm. I mean, it's truly extraordinary. And so to think that when we're sort of exerting control over our own reproductive possibilities, essentially through in vitro fertilization, through genetic screening, all of these sorts of things, that there won't be significant implications for us as a species, as individuals, as a culture, as cultures, I think is very much putting one's head in the sand just because of all these previous examples.
Well, let's look at the pros and cons. The pro side would be that dogs are very plentiful and successful in North America, while Canis lupus, the gray wolf, is near extinction in many areas. And so the dog benefited by genetic enhancement being close to humans. But dogs also have lots of genetic defects, because of all the inbreeding that took place over thousands of years. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think that there are... There are inbreeding issues, especially with certain breeds. I believe that many dogs have a longer life expectancy, certainly, than the gray wolf in the wild. But yes, there will be consequences of that sort, and especially when you have the kind with sort of crude. The kinds of selective tools that one uses and in natural breeding, you're much more likely to get these sorts of issues because you have large clusters of genes that are exchanged and you have inbreeding problems and such. I would imagine that those will be less significant when this occurs in humans for several reasons. One is that the advances in medical technology are such that they mute some of the problems that might otherwise be significant. For example, the most obvious, or a very obvious example of that is eyesight, where virtually everyone over the age of 40 requires glasses, and we wouldn't be very functional without them. And yet we don't even look at it as a disability. And there are a variety of other kinds of what would have been even fatal diseases that no longer are such. And in fact, that has had a huge impact in the spread of various mutations that would otherwise be very, very debilitating, because we survive longer. We reach reproductive age when otherwise we might not have. So I see that as one reason that these are less likely, that they're unlikely to be things that we can't deal with. And another is that we're really understanding human biology and life in general in a much more profound and nuanced way.
And also look at our dinner table. Believe it or not, much of the foods we eat for dinner have been genetically enhanced by humans over thousands of years. But if you look at corn, even though corn was domesticated by Native Americans, corn cannot exist without humans. The kernels don't fall off without human intervention. Therefore, corn is very plentiful, very shiny, very tasteful. But it is totally dependent upon humans for reproduction. Without humans, corn cannot exist. What are your thoughts?
Well, my thoughts are several in that. First of all, virtually all of the foods that we eat are the product of human breeding in one way or another. So the idea that there are natural foods is just demonstrates an ignorance of the whole process by which all of the grains and staples that we eat are how they evolved. I mean, a potato was a little thing the size of a pea, for example, and the same thing, as you mentioned, with corn. The second is that I agree that we're likely not to be able to survive in an environment that it does not have technology. And in fact, that's already the case, not just because of our biology, but look at our population. We couldn't support the human population without the kinds of high technology, agriculture, and such that we have. And so the population is way beyond the level that it could we could live in a subsistence kind of a lifestyle. Many individuals who give birth to children, and they wouldn't be able to do that outside of a hospital. I mean, you have all sorts of interventions, which those interventions make it more likely that such problems will be more significant, not less, in the future. So I think that we are definitely increasingly adapted to a high-technology, human-centered sort of an environment, and the idea that we're going to go back in some way or would even have the possibility of doing that, I think, is there is no real possibility that that could occur.
Okay, so we talked about the past where everything, including our dinner table, dogs, cats, horses, sheep, all of them have been tinkered with and enhanced to some degree by human intervention. Now let's talk about today. We see science fiction movies where life forms can be manipulated at will, but isn't it true that gene therapy, the simplest example of just fixing a broken gene, that's really in its infancy? And that there's really only one disease that can be so-called cured using gene therapy, and that's called the Bubble Boy Syndrome, or SCIDS. So aren't we at the beginning of this technology?
Very much at the beginning. I would differ sharply, though, with your assessment that that is the simplest of the sort of interventions that one can think of. It's actually probably the most difficult. And the reason for that is that if you're going to try and do genetic interventions, you have to find a mechanism for putting in place a significant segment of DNA and the control mechanisms to determine when that would be turned off on and off appropriately, and then get them into individual cells in an already existing body. That's a very, very difficult and challenging process, and an unnatural one in many ways, in the sense that the much easier and simpler way to do that would be to select or alter the genes that are in the first cell of the human embryo, and then they would be copied into every cell in the human body, along with structures that would turn them on and off, orchestrate their activity at the appropriate times and places. And that's kind of the way our genetics works naturally, in that we have every cell in the body has the same genes. It's just that different clusters of them are turned on in, say, bone than in skin or in neural tissue. And so these are the kinds of things that are possible and are much, much simpler than genetic interventions, which I think Jim Watson said that if you waited to do germline intervention, which are those that are to embryos and single cells, that if you waited for somatic engineering, the kinds of genetic interventions that are done today, to be successful, you'd wait until the sun froze over.
Okay, well, if you are Jewish, you have to worry about Tay-Sachs. If you are Caucasian, you have to worry about cystic fibrosis. And in fact, in Brooklyn, there's even a group of Orthodox Jews who get screened. And if the embryos, via implantation, if the embryos carry the bad gene, you can reject them. And in that way, they hope to literally eliminate that gene from that population. So what are some other ways in which people today can actually begin to tinker with the genetics of their children?
Well, you mentioned it right there with actually creating a number of embryos during the process of in vitro fertilization, where you take an egg and a sperm and fertilize them in a petri dish, allow them to come together in a petri dish, and then you wait until they grow up to, say, the 6 or 8 cell stage. You remove one of the cells, which isn't damaging to the embryo, and then you run a genetic test on that cell, and depending on the results, you decide whether to use or discard that embryo. That's done to avoid cystic fibrosis, to avoid Tay-Sachs. In fact, in the Jewish community, there are people have genetic tests and use that as to avoid marriages that would likely lead to children with such problems, and that's a common thing as well. So the idea of genetic screening is the easiest way that you could exploit the possibilities of these new technologies, because there you're not actually altering or changing, you're just reading out the genetic code, which is something that we can already do, although we'll be able to do it much more easily and rapidly and in more sophisticated fashions, and then making a decision based on that. So there is no risk involved, essentially, or very, very limited risks involved. And that, I think, is going to be the first application that is widespread, and that will happen relatively quickly.
Okay, now let's look at maybe a 20-year timeline, and then we'll look into the next 100, 200 years, which, of course, borders on science fiction. Mm-hmm. But let's take a look at a 20-year timeline. What kinds of therapies, what kinds of procedures are going to be available within that time frame, a 20-year time frame?
So in a 20-year time frame, I think there will be some sort of niche technologies which gain a lot of publicity today but aren't really very interesting, things like human cloning and such, which I think, even if broadly available, would only be used by very small numbers of people. The kinds of genetic engineering technologies which I've discussed at length, where you'd actually go in and alter chromosomes and add clusters of genes and such, those almost certainly will not be used other than possibly in animals, and they're already being used a little bit in animals, within that time frame. The kinds of things that will be dramatically more sophisticated and will be widely available within a 20-year time frame will be the genetic screening technology that we just discussed. And there, one will be not only screening for genetic diseases, which is already done today for a few genetic diseases, it'll be done much more broadly and in a much more nuanced fashion. But I believe that there will be choices being made based on matters of temperament and personality and predispositions that involve risk for certain, for manic depression or other kinds of disorders that, you know, are only on the borderline viewed as diseases. And so there will be basically parents, prospective parents, will be exerting choices over the genetic makeup of their children based on their individual preferences and wants.
Okay, let's talk about that now, because let's look at a 20-plus year horizon, 20, 50-year horizon, let's say, when some of the genes for attractiveness are isolated. There was a blip in the media the other day stating that shoppers spend more time taking care of their attractive children than they do with their unattractive children. And parents, of course, spend thousands of dollars on violin lessons for their children and SAT lessons to enhance their children to get into college to increase their reproductive success. But wouldn't parents therefore be hardwired not just to give violin lessons, but to actually make the children more attractive?
Well, almost certainly to pick certain traits. I think one gets into surprising choices that people would make that some of us would not consider to be enhancement, but would be so in the eyes of the parents. And what I'm referring to is, for example, that deaf parents have already, I've spoken to deaf parents who have said, or interacted with deaf parents who have said that they would use such technology to ensure that their children, not that their children were hearing, but that they were deaf, so that they could fit better into the environment, that they could, into the deaf culture, that they would be able to interact more with them as parents. So the choices that people make are very interesting. Some people would like to enhance one's IQ and intelligence. Another would be interested in aspects of physicality or in appearance. And I think there will be very, very, very diverse choices that are being made. But yes, parents will definitely want to make those choices and, in fact, will make those choices.
And, in fact, if you just found out that the Joneses next door had their kid genetically enhanced and your kid, who is not enhanced, has to compete against the Joneses' kid. Won't you therefore make a beeline to the nearest genetic enhancer so that your kid is competitive against your next-door neighbor's kid?
Yeah, maybe. It's sort of interesting, though, because the difficulty of you applying the technology will be directly proportional to the amount of enhancement that one exerts. So to actually create, for instance, super children in one way or another, no matter what the trait is, will be very complex and very slow in coming, whereas the possibility of improving some vector of performance from below average to average or average to slightly above average will be much, much easier. So there'll tend to be a leveling that will occur when these technologies are applied. I think of it as like giving parents the ability to create a virtual projection of some of the aspects of that would likely be manifested in future children, and then to make choices among those virtual siblings that they would that would be represented by embryos. So, yes, it could create significant enhancements in various dimensions and do it very, very rapidly if, in fact, for example, what we know about the genetic basis for IQ, which is not insignificant at all, certainly probably over 50% from twin studies, identical twins reared together and reared apart, a whole variety of studies in that realm. If you could identify the many genes that are involved in that and make choices based on them, you would, within a single generation, parents would probably increase the IQ of their kids by perhaps 20 points when they, if that was what really interested them. So that's a huge step in a very short period of time. And I think that there would be movement in many, many different directions, so that there would sort of be a radiation of human form.
Okay, well, let's take these one at a time because you raise a whole bunch of things. Strength. Just recently, scientists have been studying a gene which makes a mouse muscle-bound. The mouse has tremendous muscles. They call that mouse a mighty mouse in the media. And that gene, or a counterpart of that, has been found in children now, human children. And the question is, what does it mean to be an Olympic sportsman or sportswoman? What does it mean to be a Yankee home run batter if it's all just a question of genetic enhancement?
Well, I think it's going to be a real interplay of many, many factors, of which genetics will be a very, very important one and a requirement, essentially. That, I mean, if you know relatively early on today whether you have the genes, whether you have the physique that you're going to be competitive at a world-class level, that you even have the hope of being competitive in various sports. And you'd have to combine with that an incredible drive and an environment that nurtured that. I would say that if you had 50 clones of Michael Jordan, that not all of them would be superstars. That there would be other factors that would intervene to avoid those, you know, to interfere with that or to prevent that in one way or another. But, so what does it mean to be a superstar? Well, today, it used to be that there were amateur athletes, and now today, for somebody to perform at a world-class status, in a sort of a world-class status, you have to basically be devoted to a sport from a very, very early age and make it your career. And that certainly wasn't the case. So the sense of what it takes to be a professional at a world-class level will just continue to be refined. And I suspect that you may eventually reach the point where it's like having a race car, where, you know, there's a whole team, including physicians and others, that are the support sort of group for any world-class athlete.
Okay, well, we have numerous steroid scandals, and we believe in a meritocracy, that you should work at being a great athlete, not simply take a steroid and hit the ball out of the ballpark. And yet here we're talking about something even greater than steroids, actually literally changing the genetic structure of your muscle and bones, right? So won't that also create a scandal?
Well, I think it will create a change in the way people look at these things, because as it is right now, the idea that there is going to be sort of a natural Olympics in some way, or that there are sports where people do not use various aids of one sort or another, you know, that's really, as we've seen in baseball, that's really not the case. And the idea that we're going to be able to enforce those things is very unlikely as well, because the monetary rewards are too significant for success. And so it's just a constant battle between those who are trying to enhance in one way or another through genetic, through drugs, through all sorts of things, and those who are trying to discover those. And actually, there are certain incentives for the sports organizations to see increased performance. It'll be interesting to see what will happen to the perceptions of the game if, in fact, performance settles back and isn't as strong as when, new home run records were being set. So I think that as we move ahead, that it's going to become increasingly accepted that we manipulate our bodies in a variety of ways using interventions. What we will not want to see is ways in which these are dangerous interventions. But I would like to say, what are you going to do if, in fact, there is something that you could take that would increase performance or increase one's memory or increase any aspect of one's functioning and, in fact, is not dangerous, where there are no side effects that are adverse? It's sort of a recreational drug of sorts, but one without the side effects of many of the ones today. Are we ourselves not going to want to take those? I mean, remember, we take things to put ourselves to sleep, to wake ourselves up, to kill pain, to, you know, we intervene in all sorts of ways with legal pharmaceuticals. So the line between what is a pharmaceutical and what is an illicit drug is going to be an increasingly arbitrary one, and those discussions will seem a little bit surreal as we move forward.
Well, I'm afraid that's it for Exploration. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, inviting you to join us every week when we discuss science and its impact on society. And our special guest today was UCLA Professor Greg Stock, talking about the possibility of one day redesigning the human race. How far should we go? Should we even think about that? All these questions are facing us because technology is marching ever faster into the future. And if you want a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230.